Welcome back, everybody. And for the last hour, I will talk about things which are totally different from what we talked during two previous hours. Again, this will be some background needed to introduce Shram-Lovner revolution. And I'll start with a very brief review of one-dimensional Brownian motion. Again, we'll talk a lot about objects generated by Brownian motion, so it makes sense to remember what it is. So one-dimensional Brownian motion is a process defined on some probability space. So as usual for us, omega would be just a set, F sigma algebra of subsets, and P is a probability measure on the sigma algebra, such that for all omega and omega, this BT of omega. So when we talk about process on probability space, it means that it's really a function of two variables, time and, well, random variable, which we, exact nature of which will not be important for us. And we will assume that we always start at zero and always our function is continuous. And then the last property will characterize it, that if you have a sequence of times, increased sequence of times, finite sequence, then all these variables, Brownian motion at time t1, bt2 minus bt1, btn minus btn minus 1, will be independent of each other, normal, normally distributed, zero mean, and variance of them, quadratic variance, would be t1, t2 minus t1, tn minus tn minus 1 correspondingly. So from elementary property of normal properties of normal distributions, it's actually easy to see that instead of assuming t, we could have assumed much less. We could have assumed that for all t, e of expected value of Brownian motion is equal to zero for every t, and that the correlation between them, expectation of BTBS, is just minimum of T and S. Again, from this you can, from this property, you can easily derive this. Okay, so that by definition is a Brownian motion, and the first thing first is that we can have another point of view here, is that this is just a probability measure of on all continuous functions on zero infinity, such that almost surely, well, always, B of zero is equal to zero, and such that if you pick any time t, then either this C or this C, which is equivalent, is satisfied. So again, you can either look at it as a two-parameter random family, or you can look at it as a probability measure on the space of continuous functions itself. Leads to the same object. And well, such a thing exists. This is a theorem of Norbert Wiener. And I will not prove it here. It's surprisingly not that easy. But again, I will not spend time on this. So we'll have to just believe me or read the proof somewhere that Brownian motion exists. And more than that, it's unique. So let's look at some elementary properties of it. So if you have two random processes which satisfy this on different probability spaces, maybe, then there is a measure preserving transformation between omega and omega one, which would map one to the other. So it is unique in this sense. It doesn't mean that we cannot take two independent copies, any number of independent copies of this continuum of independent copies. But as an object, it's unique up to this measure preserving transformation. Another very important property is Markov property. So it states that if you pick any time s and you look at increments of Brownian motion, B of t plus s minus B of s, it's again a Brownian motion. Well, how would you establish this? You just need to check the three properties, and they are almost obvious. You start at zero, check because you were continuous. The trajectories are still continuous because you just keep going from B of s, and then correlations are the same, well, simply because this is actually easier to check because the differences are the same. So this is indeed a Brownian motion again. By the same reasoning, if you reflect Brownian motion minus BT, it's again a Brownian motion because all the correlations stays the same and all the normal distribution is invariant with respect to reflection symmetric. Okay, so here is, remember where we finished this chordal Loewner revolution, that there is Brownian scaling for driving function. And here is the reason why it is called Brownian scaling. If you take any positive C and you consider Brownian motion multiplied by C, but then taken at the time T over C squared, that's again Brownian motion. Again, the proof is very easy because this is clearly starts at zero, goes to goes continuously. And then for the correlations, when you multiply the process by C, its quadratic variation is multiplied by C squared. So you really need to divide time by C squared to keep, say, this identity true. Okay, and now the first thing that I will kind of prove is time reversal. So suppose that you, instead of Brownian motion, you consider t b of 1 over t for t bigger than 0 and 0 at 0. Then I claim that xt is a Brownian motion. So you can reverse time. You can run from infinity. And you, this is running from infinity. And you get to 0. Okay, so now all you need to do is to check first covariances. So expectation of t b of 1 over t s b of 1 over s is, well, s t out. Expectation of b 1 over t 1 over s, this is just minimum of s t. Because again, this expectation of this would be minimum of 1 over t 1 over s, so 1 over maximum of st, so st divided by maximum is equal to minimum. So okay, so correlations are good. Continuity for positive t is obvious. What about continuity at zero? So look at rational times. So at rational times, xt has exactly the same distribution as Brownian motion. So for rational times, limit of xt when t goes to zero and t is rational, and we need countability here, is the same as limit of Brownian motion. Because again, they since they are distributed the same, they agree almost surely. So that's why, again, we need, so this would be recurrent topping. That's why we need countable set here. Because if I do almost surely uncountably many times, I can get something of full measure or full probability. So that doesn't work. But if I do it countably often, this still would hold almost surely. So xt has almost surely has the same distribution of bt for every given t. Bt goes to zero, so xt goes to zero. And now, since Q is dense in R, we see that the limit when t goes to zero of xt is equal to zero too, because again, for continuous function, it's enough to prove the limit only at rational point, only on dense set. And this is x of zero. So x of t is actually continuous. That finishes the proof. And of course, this immediately implies an easy version of growth at infinity, that bt grows slower than t will have much better theorem later, that with probability one, bt over t goes to zero, because bt over t is x of one over t, and as we know, x of one over t goes to zero. Okay, so this is time reversal. And now, very important property of Brownian motion, which is existence of quadratic variation. So let me first define the quadratic variation for a general process. So suppose that xt is a real valued process. We say that x has a finite quadratic variation time t if we can do the following. Take a partition of the interval from zero to t and look simply at the sum of the squares, xti minus xti minus one squared. And now let the size of the partition, the maximum distance as usual between ti and ti minus one, go to zero. Then we claim, that's the definition, that limit and probability of this sum of xti minus one squared, well, it's actually the quadratic variation, xxt. So that's the notation. So let me draw the contrast with what we usually know. So we usually like to integrate with respect to functions of bounded variation, where instead of square, you have absolute value here. So having finite quadratic variation, non-zero quadratic variation, means that, of course, we cannot have bounded oscillation. So one of the challenges of ETA integration, of stochastic integration, would be to integrate with respect to objects which just have quadratic variation. So all we know for now is that if it exists, it's an increasing and, in general, random function. Except that, of course, this random part disappears for Brownian motion. So the first interesting theorem which I would present here is that quadratic variation of Brownian motion is actually just t. So it's nothing else than just t. And the proof uses very important formula, which will actually be useful to us at the end of the course. It's Wick's formula. And it tells us how to take expectation of product of centered normal variables. So let me remind you that centered means that expectation is zero. And it's due to Italian mathematician Gian Carlo Wick. And so actually, well, he's not a mathematician, he's a physicist mostly, yes. So expectation of the product of n variables is the following. You consider all perfect matchings of one and n. So you separate it in two pairs in all possible ways. In particular, when n is odd, there is no such separation. So you consider all the pairings, let's call them ik, jk, and then you take the products of expectations over all these pairings. So pairwise expectations, as you know, for normal variables, they define all other properties, they define total distribution of them. But this particular formula actually tells us how to find this product. So the expectation of the product is just you take perfect pairings, you take the product of expectations over pairs, so products of correlations, and then you just sum it up. So in particular, that's what we will use here, but again, later we'll use the full formula, that expected value of x to the 4, how to obtain it by this formula? There are four instances of x. There are three ways to perfectly pair them, right? So this is 4 times 3 divided by 4, three ways to perfectly pair them. But each of them, each of the perfect pairings involve pairing x's with x's twice. So 3 times e of expectation of x squared squared. So expectation of fourth power is just 3 squares of quadratic relation. Okay. Let's prove X formula. And for this, we will use the standard machinery here, characteristic functions. So let me remind that if x is a normal variable, then expectation of tx is just e to the minus t squared sigma over 2, where sigma is just quadratic variation expectation of x squared. Okay, and so for now, let's look at expectation of the product of e to the ti xi, where ti just variables. So now let's remember that this guy, sum of the normals with coefficients is still normal. So expectation of this by this exciting formula is just expectation of 1/2 times expectation of sum of ti xi squared. And so this would become expectation of 1/2 sum of ti tj expectation of xi xj. Okay, so now let us try to expand it in two ways. One way is we look at this expectation. We write this guy. So we expand each of them separately. So this is expectation of the product of 1 plus ti xi plus 1 ti squared xi squared and so on. So we just do the expectation. And so what we're interested in is a coefficient in front of t1, t2 up to tn. That's why I said that this would be variables. And this is expectation of the just product of xi, of course, because the only way to get t1, t2, tn is just to take this times this times this. Okay, so we can either expand this term immediately, or we can try to look here. So let's expand this guy. So this would be just expectation of, well, sum of I less than j ti tj plus 1/2 expectation of xi with xi. And now we just expand each of the exponents, right? So this is a product of exponents. We just expand them. So we just expand each of them in the Taylor series. And we look for a coefficient in front of t1, t2, tn. And the only way to get the coefficient in front of t1, t2, tn, well, you cannot get it from here. No, not from here. So the only way to get it is to look at perfect pairing. So you take the product of the guys here, which include all the coefficients. And that would be exactly this. And you are done. So Again, we just look at the Taylor expansion of this with respect to TIs. And we look at the coefficient in front of T1, T2, TN. You can easily see that you can get lots of other formulas this way if you look at other coefficients. But again, this is Vick's formula. And again, out of the whole big Vick's machinery, we'll just use this identity. Okay, so now let us prove the quadratic variation formula. What we'll prove is slightly more. So here we want to show that this converges here in probability. We'll actually show that it converges in L2. So we'll show that the expectation of this sum minus t, expectation of the square, tends to zero. So which means that it converges in L2 norm. So since it converges in L2 norm, it converges in probability, of course. Okay, and so how do we do it? We simply write it down as, well, we just separate t. So we just give b of ti minus b of ti minus one, and here we get ti minus ti minus one. So we just entered different parts of t corresponding to the intervals in the summation. And so now let's take the square, let's open the bracket. So this would become expectation of the sums of bti minus one to the fourth, minus two sums expectation of minus two sum of bti minus one squared, ti minus ti minus one, plus sum of ti minus one squared. Okay, so now let's compute it. You know that expectation of bti minus one squared is ti minus one. So by Vick's formula, expectation of the fourth power is three times ti minus one. So this sum after you take expectation becomes three sum of ti minus one. Now here, this is deterministic. So you just take expectation of this guy. So this becomes ti minus one squared. And then finally we add this sum of ti minus one. And this is twice sum of ti minus one squared. So which is bounded by two times the maximum number of the maximum distance between ti minus one times the sum of ti's minus ti minus one, which is t. And this tends to zero. So that's it. So Brownian motion has quadratic variation. And this quadratic variation is just very deterministic, it's t. As we will see, quadratic variation is kind of natural time for processes like Brownian motion, for martingales and local martingales. And Brownian motion is immediately kind of in this natural parameterization. So the usual corollary of such results would be that almost surely Brownian motion has infinite variation. So it's not bounded variation, it's infinite variation on any interval AB. Well, that's easy. We know that sum of bti minus one squared tends in probability to be minus a when size of the partition decreases to zero. So we can select a subsequence which tends almost surely. And now observe that the sum is bounded by the maximum of bti minus one multiplied by variance of b from a to b, right? Because again, square is bounded by supreme times the sum of absolute value. Now pass to the limit and notice that Brownian motion is continuous, so this happily tends to zero. And we just see that B minus A is less equal than zero times variance. So if variance less than infinity, we arrive to a contradiction. So not only Brownian motion is sometimes not nice, it's always, almost surely, well, it's not nice on any interval. It's infinite variation. But still we would be able to integrate with respect to it. And here, let me list some continuity properties of Brownian motion without proving it. So first, let's look at oscillation of Brownian motion. So let's take Brownian maximal difference between Brownian motion in two points, which are at most epsilon from each other. Then with probability one, this maximal oscillation behaves like square root of t. Well, with this very precise formula, the theorem of Levy, that it's actually 2t log 1 over t to the 1/2. So with probability one, oscillation, epsilon oscillation of Brownian motion is about 2 epsilon log of 1 over epsilon to the 1/2, and actually to the point that ratio of them tends to 1, exactly 1. More than that, we have a law of iterated logarithm. So when t goes to zero, Brownian motion oscillates like square root of 2t log log of 1 over t. Okay, and so when you apply time reversal, you see that the same behavior persists at infinity. It also at infinity, what we proved, that it behaves slowly than t, but actually it behaves like square root of 2t log log of t. And more than that, for a given t, it's very important that it's for given t, surely b of t plus s minus b of t behaves like square root of 2s log log s. And in Lim-Sup, Brownian motion oscillates, so there will be lots of points where b of t plus s is equal to b of t. But when you take Lim-Sup, this deviation would be about square root of 2s over log log s. So remember when we discussed Hölder continuity of Brownian motion, it barely fails to be 1/2 Hölder continuous. It slightly was then 1/2 Hölder, because there is also log log s term here. So definitely Brownian motion as a driving function would not satisfy Lin's theorem. Okay, so that's what I wanted to say about general Brownian motion. Now, let's talk about some notation which would be of crucial interest of us to us later. So let's talk about filtrations and adapted processes. So let's look at measurable space. So F is just the sigma algebra of subsets of omega. And filtration is an increasing family FT of sigma algebras, which are sub sigma algebras of S. So if T is less or equal than S, FT is subset of FS. So measurable space with filtration is called filtered space. And this index I can be N, it can be two-sided Z, so it can be discrete time, or it can be even half line or the whole real line. And my favorite filtration is this. So our omega now is interval 0, 1. And sigma algebra is a Borel sigma algebra. And Bn is sigma algebra generated by all the dyadic interval of length 1 over 2n. So let me add that there is a sigma here. So it's a minimal sigma algebra, which contains all these guys. So it's finite. And the standard situation here is that each of these sigma algebras was finite, but together they generated the whole Borel sigma algebra. So this would be a very nice filtration, which we'll use a lot. Actually, which is very useful in analysis too, not only in probability. And now very important definition of adapted process. So a process is adapted to filtration Ft if Xt is Ft measurable. That's all. So for example, process adapted to dyadic filtration is simply a process which is constant on every dyadic interval, k, k plus one, from k to the n to k plus one to the n. Because again, so what does it mean that it's adapted? It means that preimage of every open set should be subset of this, should be an element of this Ft. And here it means that you should be constant here. And in that direction, if you are given a process, then there is a smallest filtration, which we call natural filtration, such that for all t, xt is ft measurable. And this filtration is, again, this is the smallest sigma algebra, such that all these sets, xs less than a, are measurable for all s less or equals than t and a in R. So that would be your natural filtration for the process. And then you also have left and right filtration. So left filtration is simply sigma algebra generated by all previous guys. And right filtration just intersection of all the guys here s bigger than t. So because intersection of sigma algebras is sigma algebras. Union is not, but intersection is. And finally, F infinity is sigma algebra generated by all of them. And now very important probabilistic, and again, now not only probabilistic concept of stopping time. So if you have a filtration, then stopping time is a function such that this set T of omega less equals than T belong to FT. So heuristically, it means that at time T, you know whether you already stopped or should keep going. That's why it's called stopping time. So at time T, if your knowledge is FT, is given by FT, then you know, okay, so are we already less than t or are we bigger than t? And let me give you some examples. First, start with discrete time. And suppose that xn is valued in some metric space, a subset of this metric space. And let's look for the first time when xn belongs to a. So with the assumption that infimum of empty set is infinity, t can be infinite. Then it's pretty clear that this set omega such that t of omega is less or equal than n, well, what does it mean? It means that t of omega is less or equal than n, it means that one of the xn belong to A, rather one of the xk's when k is less or equal than n. And this is union of Fn measurable sets. So this is indeed stopping time in natural filtration. Now with continuous heating time, you need to assume something. With continuous heating time, you need to assume, for example, that xt is left continuous. Then this is first heating time, infinite t such that xt is an a, is a stopping time. So this is, again, we'll need left continuity here. And so here's the proof. So what does it mean that t omega is less or equal than t? It means that xt is an a union with the following, that you can find rational q which is less than 1 over k such that the distance from this xq to a is less than 1 over is bigger than 1 over n. And then you take the union of n intersections over k. And so this is definitely an element of FT. Here I use the fact that it's enough to just check rational numbers. So again, you want to check that you hit it before. And you cannot check at all times t, because that would be the union of uncountably many sets. You can take uncountable union, but countable unions are okay. Here you are. Okay, now let's discuss relation of stopping times and Brownian motions. It's actually quite exciting. So let BT be a process adapted to a filtration FT. So this doesn't need to be a natural filtration. This will be very, very important, because again, the bigger the filtration, the finer the filtration, the more stopping times you have, the weaker the condition for thing to be stopping time. And so suppose that t is a stopping time with respect to ft, and which is less than infinity almost surely. Then we can define a new process. At time t, this would be Brownian motion at time little t plus the stopping time minus Brownian motion at time t. Then the claim is that this is still a Brownian motion, which is independent of all the things which happens before the stopping time t. So this is called strong Markov property. So remember, Markov property was that when this little t is a constant, then we have Brownian motion. Here I'm saying that if instead of constant, you assume that this capital T is just stopping time, maybe with reflex, with this respect to some big filtration, this is still Brownian motion. I will not prove this. This is not difficult, but let me save time here. Let me just do an application of this, which again is very nice. It's called reflection principle for Brownian motion. So let t be a stopping time, and let's consider reflected Brownian motion. up to time t, it's just your usual, you run it. But then after time t, you reflect it. So this is to be t minus pt. So you reflect it with respect to bt. And the claim is that bt star is a Brownian motion. Well, how do you check this? Continuity of this process is obvious. And now let us see. By strong Markov property, both this guy and this guy are Brownian motions which are independent of B of S when S is less or equal than the stopping time. Right? Because this is just by standard Markov property, strong Markov property, and this is because minus Brownian motion is again Brownian motion. So the Brownian motions independent. So which means that B of T, which is just this process, Brownian motion here, and Brownian motion plus B1. Well, that's our standard Brownian motion. And now reflected Brownian motion, this which is BT plus B2 after time T. Well, they have the same correlations. Because when you correlate things, well, before and after the time t, that the correlations of the same object, they consist of two parts. Brownian motion before, bt plus independent Brownian motion after, independent of this. So they have the same finite correlations, which means that they have the same distribution, so it means that they are both Brownian motions. Remember, Brownian motion is determined by just pairwise correlations of BS and BT, if it is continuous. And again, continuity is, because this reflection makes it continuous at T capital. Okay, so one of the corollaries of this is distribution of maximum of Brownian motion. So let ST be the maximum of Brownian motion, supremum of Brownian motion, when S less or equal than T. So remember, Brownian motion is this highly oscillating thing. So amazingly, we can say everything about the distribution of this. So first of all, probability that ST is less or equal than A, but BT is bigger or equal than B, this is the same as the probability that the Brownian motion at time t is bigger or equal than 2a minus b. Second is that probability that st is bigger or equal than a is just probability that absolute value of bt bigger or equal than a. This is the same as twice the probability that bt equal, bigger equal than a. Well, this equal to this just by reflexivity of Brownian motion, but by symmetry of normal distribution. This is equal to this. So we know the distribution of st. Probability that st is bigger than a is just twice the probability that bt is bigger than a. So it's kind of half normal, because again, it's positive. Okay, so to prove it, let us look at the first time we hit A. Then probability that ST is bigger or equal than A and BT is equal less or equal than B, it's okay. So here actually made a mistake as usual. Here I didn't like it. So here, what is T is bigger or equal than A, and BT is less or equal than B. Yes, that would be better. This is the probability that you hit this level A before time T, and BT is less or equal than B. Now, this is a probability that TA is less or equal than T. And then let's do the reflection. So let's, Let's do the stop Brownian motion. Let's start Brownian motion at the time TA. And this is, so this is exactly the same as B of TA, T minus T is less or equal than B minus A. And so B of TTA, let's remember it's B of T minus B of TA. So this is a probability that TA is less or equal than T. And now we reflect it. So BT less or equal than B, it's the same as BT star is bigger than equal than 2A minus B. Okay, and now this is exactly the same as the probability that BT star is bigger or equal than 2A minus B. Because again, if T less than T, then BT star, which is if TA is bigger than T, then what we have is that BT is less than A. So BT star is less than bigger than 2A minus B. And so this is, since this is the same object as this, we have that the probability of ST bigger than A and BT less or equal than B is the same as the probability that BT is bigger or equal than 2A minus B. Okay, so this is, again, and so we are done. Now to establish two, probability that ST bigger or equal than A, it's, well, the probability that ST bigger or equal than A, BT bigger or equal than A, plus probability that ST bigger or equal than A, BT less or equal than A. But now we can reflect it with respect to TA. So this is a probability that ST bigger or equal than A, BT bigger or equal than A, plus probability that ST bigger or equal than A, BT star bigger or equal than A. Right? So one of them should be bigger than A. So this is probability of BT bigger than A, this is probability of BT star equal bigger or equal than A. And so this is just twice probability of BT bigger or equal than A. And we know that this probability that absolute value of BT is bigger or equal than A. And we are done. Okay, so that gives us the distribution of Brownian motion, of maximum of Brownian motion. Now, I will, I guess, begin the next lecture with a discussion of more general objects than Brownian motions, which eventually, at least in the continuous version, will turn out to be reparametrized Brownian motions. So we'll start with a careful discussion of conditional expectations and martingales, and then we'll go from there. Okay, so let me stop the recording here.